Today is Thursday, November the 4th. Let me say that again. Today is Thursday, November the 4th. My tongue's a little tied this morning. It's good to be on today. We're going to be looking, starting in John chapter 12, an event that we've been anticipating as we've looked at Jesus and his raising of Lazarus and his sisters Martha and Mary. We're going to see Mary again in chapter 12. But just a couple of things I want to remind you to continue to be praying for those that you know are ill, sick, different surgeries people are having, lifting up the Constantine Petresca family as they're dealing with so much. Continue to pray for them, in a sense isolated from their kids who are in Conyers, and Leah and Constantine are there in Augusta as Constantine is recovering. And so pray for them. Pray for Vanessa. She had another chemo treatment on Tuesday, and continue to pray for her. And an update, Jonathan Crow, my cousin who had had brain surgery yesterday, had her tumor removed. What I understand, everything has gone good with that. He's recovering, so be praying for Sharon Head, as that's Jonathan's mom. Last night was such a good prayer meeting. We had our corporate prayer. I'm just amazed at how God has been favorable to meet us on our first and foremost Wednesday night of prayer, where we've set prayer as a priority for the ministry here at First Conyers, and we are growing in our prayer. It was great to see the room full last night, but that's not what we're after. What we're after is what we're desiring God to do is to continue to work and grow us in our prayers, believing and knowing that God does hear our prayer when we cry out to Him. And I was just extremely uplifted and encouraged last night after having a time of prayer with the body. And so it's exciting. My prayer is that that becomes the most popular service every month here at First Conyers. And what I mean by popular, I don't mean, you know what I mean, but that we really literally begin to see God's house become a house of prayer, and we see Him answer. We're believing for God to answer some of the heartfelt cries last night for people, for God to revive us as a church and to bring spiritual awakening. And so this morning, I was just wanting to give thanks for the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King, His love endures forever. He is good, He is above all things, His love endures. Love endures forever. God is faithful. Forever God is strong. He is with us forever. He will never leave us, nor will he ever forsake us. Give praise to him this morning for that. Thank him for the fact and reality that he is forever faithful. He cannot be anything other than faithful. That is his nature and character. God cannot be unfaithful. And he has committed himself to us in relationship through his son Jesus. And that is a forever act. It's a judicial act. It's God decreed. It's God declared. And we are forever, forever, forever secure in him. Thank God for that this morning. There's neither height nor depth nor anything that can ever separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Boy, that is reason to praise him this morning. We were picking up in John chapter 12 after we know that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. And he had the dialogue with Martha and with Mary as well. And he declared himself to be the resurrection and the life. And both Martha and Mary recognized that he was a Messiah. And I believe that in that recognition, their faith was in him and they were certainly born again. And so we pick up to John chapter 12 now. From this point on in the Gospel of John, we're going to be dealing with that final week before Jesus went to the cross. And John gives more account to that than any of the other Gospel writers. And so we're going to be on a journey here, just really absorbing that last week of Jesus' life. And it was during that Passover time that Jesus made his way to Jerusalem. We're going to see that in the passage after this event that takes place. But beginning in verse 1 of chapter 12, John records for us that 6 days before the Passover, and this was the week preceding the Passover where Jesus would be crucified, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Now, Bethany was only a couple of miles from Jerusalem, so it wasn't far there. So this is the evening before his triumphal entry. And they gave a dinner for him there, and Martha served. We see Martha all of the time serving. And it is a gift, I think, that Martha had, where she loved to serve. And there are those that have that gift, that just have the gift of serving. And what a great gift it is that God has given that to the body of Christ. Maybe you are one who serves, and maybe you're one who's always kind of in the background, always serving and never up front. Well, can I tell you that that's an incredibly vital role in the body of Christ? Of course, we're all called to serve one another, but there's that particular gift that God gives some by the Holy Spirit, that gift of serving. And it is so necessary in the body of Christ to serve in so many different ways. And here we see Martha exercising that gift to serve. And she's serving all of the ones at the dinner. And Lazarus was one of those reclining at the table. I love this. Just not too long before that, Lazarus had been laid in the tomb. He was dead. And Jesus cried, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus rose from the dead by the power of Jesus demonstrating that he was God and he had authority over life and death. And he raised him from the dead. And now here we see him at the table, reclining. The tables there were really just short little tables, and they would recline against one another around the table. And here we see him reclining with Jesus. I just tried to imagine this morning what that must have been like for Lazarus. Not just to be in the midst, in the presence of celebrity, but being in the midst of the one that he knew, in fact, was God. And now here he is breaking bread with Jesus. It kind of reminds me and makes me think about, although that really is not the interpretation in this passage, but it does make me think about the marriage supper of the Lamb, that the Bible teaches that when God raises believers from the dead, we'll be united with him, and we will be reclining with him at the table at the marriage supper of the Lamb, the celebration after Jesus comes back. And so, in one sense, we're all going to be able to recline at the table with Jesus, and Lazarus is here, undoubtedly, probably with his head against his breast and leaning with him there. Verse 3, in the middle of this dinner, Mary takes an expensive jar of lard, really, of ointment with spices that would be mixed in it. And oftentimes this ointment would be used to embalm one, if you will, or after they had passed away, to dress the body in this ointment. And she takes this very expensive jar of ointment, of alabaster oil, some gospels record for us, that had been made from pure nard, and she anointed Jesus's feet, or anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. Now, all of the gospel accounts record an instance where an individual or a woman anoints Jesus's feet with the oil and with their tears and wipes his feet. Matthew, Mark, and John, we know specifically this is the same Mary in all of these three instances, the sister of Lazarus. There's also an account in the Gospel of Luke in chapter 7 where a woman had anointed Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair as she cried and her tears literally dropped on his feet. And there's debate whether or not this is the same Mary. I don't know whether it is or not. But we find it very significant that all of the gospel writers record this. And there are a number of things that come to mind when I think of this woman, Mary. The first thing is that Mary had a recognition of how holy God was and how sinful she was, and in the fact that Jesus would go to the cross, suffer at the hands of sinful man, he who knew no sin. She knew Jesus. She was in fellowship with Jesus. She walked with him in his earthly ministry. She entertained him in their home. She'd gotten to know him. And she recognized that he would suffer as a payment for her sin. And I can only imagine that in Mary's mind, she's thinking, here this one is who is the most holy person that I've ever seen, God, very God. And to think that he would be willing to lay his life down so that I might have eternal life. And I want us to just stop and pause this morning, as I did earlier, to think and recognize how utterly sinful and selfish we are to our very core. There's probably not a thing that we do that doesn't have some element of selfish motive to it. And how far separated we are from God, that the spotless Lamb of God, Jesus himself, who knew no sin, who did not deserve what he received, the punishment that he received, did not deserve our sins to be laid on him, that the writer Paul would say that he who knew no sin became a sin offering for us. Just reflect on that for just a moment, that Jesus would do that so that we might be saved. Ultimately, so that he would be glorified in doing what only he could do, and that is to save a wretched sinner like you and I. And I can only imagine that this may have been what was on Mary's mind when she took that expensive jar of alabaster and anointed Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. Typically, the anointing would take place where the oil would be poured on the head of an individual. But here, she pours that on his feet, and she wipes his feet with her hair. Now, think about that for just a moment. Bowing at his feet is symbolism, is a recognition of bowing down and worshiping him. To wash another's feet in that day was customary to be done by a slave or a servant. And here Mary abases herself to the greatest degree that she possibly could. And she anoints Jesus' feet, and she begins to wipe his feet with her hair. Now, my wife told me this morning that she had to draw some cash out at the ATM so she could fix her hair. To a woman, her hair is kind of her crown of glory. I didn't ask her how much she's going to draw out. I don't even ask that question anymore. I just know it's important to her to have her hair looking good. And to think of Mary, that she would lower her hair, would take it down and would wipe the feet of Jesus with her hair. I doubt that my wife, as much as she loves me, would wipe my feet with her hair. And I think it just goes to show how much Mary had a heart of worship for Jesus. She would take her hair and she would wipe the feet of Jesus with her hair. Now, these were not clean feet like we have today that are covered with socks and shoes. These were dirty feet, covered by dust and the grime of the streets, and that she would wash his feet with her hair. Incredible. And then verse 4, but Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples who was about to betray him, said, why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? And he said this, not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. And so here Judas, trying to be all righteous, and say, you know, what a waste of this expensive perfume that you would pour it on his feet. That money could have been used to help the poor. We hear some of the same kind of things today, don't we? Why are you going to spend that kind of money to go over to that country and evangelize? We have plenty of people here that need to see it. Listen, that is just an earmark of a greedy and a greed-driven person. You see, the heart that worships says, you know what? There is nothing that is that is too valuable that I would not give it up for Jesus. And it causes me to think, what is it that I hold on to that I'm not willing to give and sacrifice so that Christ might be glorified? And ultimately, he is glorified by saving lost mankind. And so Jesus responds to Judas, and he says, leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. Jesus foreshadowing that he would be crucified and buried. And then he said in verse 8, for the poor you will always have with you, but you do not always have me. Now, Jesus wasn't indicating at all that he had no concern for the poor, but he was just stating a fact. The poor you will always have with you. We'll always have the poor with us. It's not the first time this is stated in Scripture. It was just a saying that was used then. But Jesus said, but you will not always have me with you. In other words, the ultimate sacrifice is what we give to him, not to any other person. And so this morning, as we reflect on this passage and the thoughts in this, ask the Lord, Lord, what is it that you'd have me give for you? And it may not be a material thing. It may be time. It may be your resources of that. It may be an area that God has been calling you to serve in, but you realize you've got to give up some of your own time or some of your own resources in order to give to him. Listen, there's no sacrifice that we could ever make that is greater than the reciprocal blessing of being obedient to serve him. So today, look for ways that you might serve him. Also, pray that God would give you an opportunity today to plant a seed of the gospel in somebody's heart. If you recognize the seed has already been planted there, that God would give you the wisdom and discernment to cultivate that seed so that a person might come to know Christ. And if God would allow us to be used to lead somebody to Christ today, man, what a glorious thing that would be. Well, I pray the Lord blesses you, he keeps you. His face would shine upon you. You'd have a great day. Worship him throughout the day. Whatever you do, whether you eat or drink, the Apostle Paul says, do it all to the glory of God. Well, I look forward to being with you on Sunday morning. If you're not in our location, make it a point, make it a priority to go and worship corporately with the body. That's what God has set us aside to do, that we might worship him, to be edified through the word, to be edified through the coming together of the body of Christ. Make church, make attending church a priority. I know that's an unpopular thing in today's world, but it is such a priority in our life as believers. Be faithful to that. If you're not going out still in this COVID environment, then join us online or join your local church online, wherever you might be. I love you. I pray the Lord's blessings on you, that he keep you. Have a great day.